couple was pledged to be married to Joseph, and her name was Mary. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, he did not want to expose her to public disgrace.
Amen.
But he had the voice in his mind quietly. But after he considered this, because he was thinking about it, they said she was pregnant, but he was like, okay, I'm not going to embarrass her, but I got to get out of this. Says, but the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid. I want you to remember that. Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save people from their sins.
Amen.
And this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And so after thinking about what he was going to do with Mary, and after the angel appeared, Joseph woke up. And he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him. And he took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until after she gave birth to the son.
Amen.
And he gave him the name Jesus.
Amen.
Now we heard the first reading from Luke, where they told Mary not to fear. They told her to fear not, but rejoice. Because you know what? Sometimes you got to go through fear in order to get to favor. And if you fear too much, you might not get the favor of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so here we see that he tells Joseph to fear not. And so today I want to talk to you from the topic, from the barn to the blessing. Or in other words, don't be scared.
Come on,
man. Father God, in the name of Jesus,
amen.
God, we just pray today that there are some things in this life that will make us tremble in fear. But you said we don't have to be afraid, because you have given us victory over anything that the enemy wants to give us. And so right now, God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart are acceptable in your sight. For you are my strength and our redeemer. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. So I'm going to tell y'all, you know how the kids say, don't be scared. We love getting gifts, don't we?
Amen.
We love getting gifts. We may not know what's underneath the wrapping paper, but we love seeing that we're going to get a box.
Amen.
We love seeing that we're going to get something. Amen.
Amen.
We may not be able to see under all the wrappings and trappings, but we like getting a gift. And the Bible tells us that Jesus was a gift. And as a matter of fact, in Romans 6 and 23, it says, for the wages of sin is what?
Death.
But the what? The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And not only is he a gift, it said he came gift wrapped. As a matter of fact, it said when they found him, he was laid in a manger and he was wrapped in swaddling clothes. Amen. But I want you to know there are all types of trappings that Satan has set in order when God wants to gift us with something. If you have been gifted, or God wants you to be gifted with something, a lot of times it'll come wrapped up in something, and before you can get to the gift, you gotta unwrap all the wrappings and the trappings around it.
Man.
As a matter of fact, if somebody gives you something wrapped in a box, sometimes, you know, you gotta get through the paper, you gotta get through the tape, you gotta tear the tape. Sometimes you get a paper cut because your finger gets cut on the paper. You gotta tear the paper open. And Satan is like that with us. Sometimes before we can get to the gift that God has for us, we gotta tear some stuff open. Amen. And as a matter of fact, he wants to try to tear us open before strength of God on the inside of us. And it says that there were trappings and wrappings, and they were such. As a matter of fact, it said that they had a gift for Joseph, that Jesus was going to be a gift for them. But before the angels, when the angels came, they had to tell Mary and Joseph, do not be afraid of the gift that you're going to get. Now, that's a strange thing. Because if somebody came to me and said, I got something for you, and I don't want you to be afraid to open it. Now, I'm not sure y'all want to open the package. I don't know whether a snake is coming out. I don't know whether you got it wrapped in hand wraps. And you know, if you give me a gift and say, now don't be afraid to open this, then I might do what? I might want to set that gift aside. Or I might take it and say, I'm going to open it later so that I can re-gift it to somebody else. And let them open it and find out what's going on the inside of it. I don't know whether it would make me more or less afraid to open the gift. Now, this was an angel, but when somebody says, don't be afraid, then normally we get afraid. If the doctor comes to you and says, well, I need to tell you something, but I don't want you to be afraid, you're going to think it's some bad news. You get nervous about it. Yet, that's what he said to them. As a matter of fact, I want you to know that fear can be our worst enemy. Fear can be our worst enemy. And the angels knew that. God knew that. That's why he had to tell them, don't be afraid. Because we are fearful. We like to know what's coming at us. Don't you like to know what's coming at you? We like to be able to see into the future. We want to know what's going to happen. But sometimes to get to the gift, we got to go through the trappings of the wrappings in order to get to the gift that's underneath and down on the inside. But I can assure you that whenever God has sent you a gift, there is something great, there is something powerful, there is something wonderful, and I can also assure you that if God has gifted you with something, he says, I'm going to give you something, you know that you are anointed, that the enemy is going to try to keep you from owning your gift.
Come on now. That's right.
I want you to know that the enemy is going to do everything he can to try to tear that gift up before you get through the box. Amen? Sometimes a gift will bother us before it blesses us. Sometimes a gift will irritate you before you get to the blessing. Sometimes in order to get to the blessing, you got to go through some mess. Because you know what? There was a message in the manger, but it was a lot of mess going around on the outside of the manger as well. And before you have your manger experience, you're going to have to go through some mess. You're going to have to sleep in some barnyards with some wild animals. You're going to see some dirt and some dung. But I want you to know, don't give up. I know I'm talking to somebody this morning. I don't want you to give up. Because while you are struggling to get to your gift, I want you to know there's a blessing waiting for you. That's what he told Jesus. Joseph, now, I'm going to tell you, Joseph started to think of how he could get rid of his gift. See, sometimes God has something for us, and we're like, I just don't want to deal with all this trouble. You know, they got it wrapped in five layers. I tear one layer up, then it's another layer, then I tear another layer up and I cut my finger. There's more tape. The box taped up so tight. I'm trying to get to it and I got to try to get some scissors to cut the box so that I can see what's on the inside. And so it seems like it's more of a problem than a blessing. You know, and that's the way sometimes it is with the gifts that God gives us. Sometimes we have some problems before we get to the blessing.
That's right.
I don't know how God is going to bless us with this roof, but I know that he is. There is a problem, but I know it's going to be fixed. Because I'm going to tell you, it was so funny, and I just love Kevin in the spirit. Kevin, he called and he was worried because he said, you won't believe what happened. And he told me the roof fell and he said, but Pastor, I know. He said, it's going to be all right. He said, I don't want to be the one to bring it. He was here. He was here when it happened. And I know it scared people. You know, the woods are falling in. You're sitting in the sanctuary and the wood, and you're like, because you don't know whether the wood is coming from the ceiling, whether that bell is going to fall through. You don't know what's going to happen. And we thank God that it didn't. And he said, Pastor, he said it. He said, but it's going to be all right. He said, I have to be the one to bring you the bad news. I know it's a lot going on. And you got a lot that you're dealing with. And I don't want to be the bearer of bad news. But we were sitting in choir rehearsal. And all I could think was, you know what? I got some work to do.
Come on, man.
I'm going to finish my work. And then I'm going to go to bed. I'm going to pray about this thing. Because you know what? I couldn't climb up there and fix it.
Come on, man.
Brother Hutchinson and I don't have enough money in our bank account to fix it. So I'm thinking, because my heart skipped a beat. I'm going to tell you, it skipped two or three beats. And then I thought, fear not. For behold, he is going to bring me glad tidings.
Yeah.
The head of our trustee board came out, and we were out here, and you know, all I could do was say, okay, all right, we're going to have to get some estimates. We're going to have to, first we need somebody to do an inspection. We're going to have to inspect it. If it's so bad that we got to talk to the insurance people, whatever it is, all these men sitting right here on this front row, I'm depending on every one of y'all. On Jesus. Amen. And it shall be done. And so, because you know what? You know what I realized? I could do two things. What could I do? You know, we have that serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity. Exactly. To accept the things that I cannot change. To change the things that I can. And for wisdom to know the difference. And I said, and that's what I tell them. That's what I tell them when they're going through. I said, well, okay, what can we do? Is there a way? How are we going to operate here? Now, Joseph, when he said he was going to be blessed and they told him about Mary, he said, okay, I'm thinking of how I'm going to put her away. He said, well, I'm mad enough that I don't want to embarrass her.
Yes.
He said, I got to get rid of this situation. You know, and so for me, you know, what was it? You know, tell the bishop, look, take this appointment back because the church falling apart. What was I going to do? I got to think about what the Lord, how he's going to operate. So it doesn't mean we don't think about giving up on our gifts. Amen? Sometimes we do. It says he sought to think about what he was going to do. So he was about ready to get rid of his gift. But then when they talked to him.
Come on, man.
And they talked to him while he was at rest. You know, that's why sometimes you pray about a situation and then you got to try to find, and it's hard. Yeah. It is hard, yeah. But you got to try to find peace. Because I noticed they didn't talk to Joseph when he was up and going, oh my God, what am I going to do with this woman? They said they waited until he went to sleep. And while he was at rest,
come on, man.
Then the angels came and talked to him in a dream and said, I got a solution. So sometimes we get up at midnight worrying when if you just rest in Jesus. When you just rest in Jesus, he already got the solution working out. And if you rest in him, he'll allow you to see the picture more clearly.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we understand that a gift will be wrapped in distress, and sometimes it'll be wrapped in problems. Sometimes the paper looks real good on the outside, the tracking looks real good. gift is about to be revealed, and then suddenly you're struggling to get through the pain.
Come on, man.
Suddenly, you're trying to get to the gift, and as the Lord is trying to show you that there is a gift there, the enemy is not going to let you just open up your gift. The enemy is not going to allow you to just go, oh, wow, I'm just down today and broke today. He said he got this gift, and oh, Lord, tomorrow I'm going to be rich, healthy, happy. Life's going to be great. No, no. Jesus said he came that you might have life and have life more abundantly. But Satan came to draw the enemy.
Yes.
Depression, oppression. He's not going to let you just open it up and be happy. He wants to get you struggling through it. He wants to get you frustrated. He wants to get you down so that while you're trying to open up the gift of God, you're going to give up on it. And in the middle of, and sometimes it's right at the point where you think everything is going to be all right, that you feel like you take 5 steps back. Something happens to take you back. You know, sometimes it seems for us that we're in a barnyard experience. What was the barnyard experience? See, it was in the barnyard that the Christ child was born. And sometimes we can't be scared to sit in the barnyard for a while.
Come on.
You see, God has prepared a gift in the manger, but there may be a cost. And it may not be money, but there may be a cost. Why do I say that? Because I think Joseph, see, we see these stories about Joseph and Mary traveling, and you know, we look at them like they were poor, and they traveled. Joseph couldn't have been so poor. Why? Because he had a dowry for his wife. Amen. Because he couldn't be betrothed to her without having money and a dowry to provide for her. And so he had something, but money couldn't buy what he needed. He had to get through that barnyard experience. He was, even though in the Greek it describes it a little bit differently, because in the Greek we understand that often they stay with relatives, it says he was looking for an inn to stay in.
Come on, man.
You can't go to no hotel without no money. So it wasn't that he didn't have a provision to stay there, but there wasn't a place for him to stay at that particular time. Why? Because everybody was coming for the census. So there were no vacancies available. So it didn't say he couldn't stay there because he was broke. See, he was looking for a room, but there wasn't one available. And so rather than being able to stay in a room, not because he was broke, he stayed in the next best thing that God provided for him.
Come on, man.
And see, sometimes we don't like the provision that God has.
Who told you?
See, we want to stay at the Westin or the Omni. We want to sit in the Marriott. But God said not today. It's not open. You got to sit in the barnyard. I've got a provision for you. It may not be the provision you're expecting, but he has provided. The great inn, but it was in the barnyard that he was blessed.
Yes.
I want you to know that sometimes when you think it's because God isn't providing me what I want, it doesn't mean that he's not providing you enough. because he doesn't have you in the place where you want to be, it doesn't mean that he doesn't have a provision that's good enough for where you are now. Sometimes you got to go through in order to get to what God has for you. I want you to know that the Bible says that your gift will make room for him. The preacher talk about it's gonna come, and I don't know when it's gonna come. I don't know what is going to come, but I do know this. Fear not.
Come on, man.
Don't be scared. You just hang around that box. You don't have to re-gift it. You just got to wait for God to open it up and it's there. If you trust him, there is a provision in the manger. There is a provision that he's made. Sometimes you got to go sit in the barnyard.
Come on, man. Tell it.
To get to the place.
Yeah.
For unto us a child will be born. That he was going to be born in a manger. That it was going to be wrapped in swaddling clothes.
Come on, man.
There were going to be folk looking to kill him. As a matter of fact, Herod had required that all babies two and under be killed. He was ripping babies. He was ripping babies from the homes and hearts of their mothers. And that you could hear the wails and screams of the mother as he was trying to kill them. But don't you know what God has for you is for you? He was killing them. That God said to you and to me, for the gift of God is eternal life. Is there someone this morning who knows that they are in a barnyard experience? They're just waiting on God to make the provision. Is there one this morning? If you want to come up and I'll pray with you, we're going to meet together. That your barnyard experience not for naught. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You might be sitting in the barn. Sitting in the dung right now, but you know what? In the middle of your
mind,
he can open it up. And provide a blessing for you. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I've had some barn dung experience.
Yes.
He said he'd never leave you or forsake you. He would be with them just like he was in the days of Joseph and Mary.
Hallelujah.
The provision has already been made. As I look at my musicians over there, they're young people. I want you to know, Kevin and Terrence, God is a gift with your name.
Yeah.